easy thing to do since he sent a bio. Malachy McCourt was born in Brooklyn, New York, the son of Irish parents. I was born in Queens, New York. I went to high school in Brooklyn. But Malachy was born in Brooklyn, New York, the son of Irish parents, Angela and Malachy McCourt. When he was a toddler, his family moved back to Ireland and settled in Limerick, where Malachy was raised. At the age of 21, he returned to live in New York City, and through the years, he has been a saloon keeper, a radio host, and even made a run for New York State Governor in 2006. He is best known as an actor and has appeared on stage, television, and in several movies. He has also authored 10 books. Malachy is the last of 7 children. Please, I give you Malachy McCourt.
Yeah. Thank you, Dan. Don't stop. Okay. Thank you very much, Dan. It's grand to be above ground. It's grand to be anywhere at my age. I just hit 86 the other day, and it wasn't my fault. I didn't do anything. Most of us cannot imagine our parents doing what brought us into the world, you know. Very hard to. And at my age, 86, I am in what the Irish call the departure lounge. And here I am. Well, you know, in Ireland, death is something else. It is, we celebrate, we mourn marriages, and we celebrate death. And that, yeah, if you're in a pub, you know, you hear a couple of guys talk and say, Jesus, did you hear about Mick? What? He's gone. What? Yep, finished, over. We won't see him again. What happened? He got married on Saturday. And so that's the way they look at it. And so I thought I might do a little reading. My mother, Angela, by the way, Dan mentioned my brother Frank, and he did write Angela's Ashes. And also, in case I have written 10 books, but my next book is called I Read Your Brother's Book. So you. So anyway, in 1981, can you hear me all right? Right? Oh, good. At the end of her holiday visit to the USA, one that lasted 23 years, the mother, Angela, was in Lenox Hill Hospital dying from the ravages of cigarette smoking, which had destroyed her lungs. She had started the deadly habit, according to herself, at about the age of 13, and must have smoked thousands of the fags called Woodbine over the next 40 years, cutting her lungs' ability to access the air that is entirely free and accessible. She lingered at Lenox Hill Hospital for several months, all the time complaining that they were prolonging her now very uncomfortable life. When I asked her if she wanted to be buried or cremated, she said, "Surprise me." She complained to me that abortions were allowed, but they would not help people have a good death. One doctor suggested to her that she live out her remaining life in a nursing home. No one lives in a nursing home, the mother said. You barely exist there. I discussed letting her die with a doctor who invoked ethics and law as obstacles to sending her off. Sometimes we don't know where words come from, but out these ones came from me. Don't worry, doctor, I said. We come from a long line of dead people. He looked at me like a man who had just been bitten on the testicles by a rabid rat, his eyes moving swiftly from one side to the other, seeking escape, which he did down the hall, leaving me with one hand raised, trying to remember the word euthanasia. At one point, a priest came in and offered her some religious comforts, and Angela informed him the church had been entirely absent in the days when she could have used it, and that now that she was at the end of her life, she did not need any of the church's help. The priest was followed by a psychiatrist who hopped in to talk to her about how she felt. After a bit of chat, he expressed the opinion that she was depressed. How long did you spend in school to come up with that one? Angela asked. I can't breathe, I have a bad heart, a broken hip, and spend every hour of every day lying in a hospital bed. I can barely move. I think you're right, I am depressed. Various bingo buddies arrived with cheery optimism. They would assure Angela that she'd been up and about by Christmas, and in fact, she somehow did pull herself out of the hospital bed to attend my 50th birthday party. Though the mother knew better than anyone, even the doctors, how dire her situation was, part of her wanted to believe that she would survive. There, the reality would creep back in and she would become sorrowful. I had to tell her friends not to talk about her getting better and just understand she was dying and say goodbye. Very quietly one night, one of the nurses came in and removed the various tubes and needles, took off Angela's rings and gave them to me. Alfie and Frank had done their shift on the night watch, and it was my turn. At about 2 a.m., Angela emerged from her twilight sleep, opening one blue eye and addressing me. "What are you doing there?" she said. "I thought you might die tonight," I said. "I might and I might not, but that's my business," she said. "Why don't you go home to your bed? Are you sure you want me to go?" "Yes, go home," she said. She then closed her eye, thus dismissing me, and I left. Not a couple of hours later, I received the call from the hospital that she had died. Frank, Mike, and self were severely deficient in the money department at that time, so it fell to the brother Alfie to pick up the tab at the funeral home. At the time, Alfie owned a successful Mexican restaurant called Los Panchos. Frank, Alfie, and his wife, Lynn, Diana, and I all went to the old funeral home and met up with the death profiteer. We sat in a semicircle in stiff chairs in front of a large oaken desk, behind which he sat with his fingertips together like the arch of a church. And the polish on his fingernails seemed to glimmer. He had golden hair, a gold watch, and a gold tie pin, and his smile, which made it look as though he was experiencing some painful gas, revealed the gold tooth. I leaned into Brother Frank. "This is going to cost Alfie," I said. Of course came the well-practiced condolence, the hushed tone, the pain smile, the lowering of the eyelids. The director murmured a few phrases about our loss and the importance of a dignified death, from which he deftly pivoted into his sales pitch. Out came the laminated binder with the high glossy photos of every conceivable kind and make of coffin. There were themes for baseball fans, duck hunters, and fly fishers. I imagined Angela spending all eternity looking up at a largemouth bass. Choices came in mahogany, walnut, cherry, maple, oak, pecan, poplar, and pine. There were bronze, copper, and stainless steels for long-lasting, better protection, the funeral director said, which brought images of worms and eye sockets. There was no room then for the domestic deluxe Promethean back then, which the king of pop, Michael Jackson, who died some years later, was buried in. A 24 carat gold plated sarcophagus knows the golden send off. That did not seem to be the case with us. "You'll want the teak," the director began, "with gold handles and the blue satin lining. The pillow that comes with this set is silk." At the time, negotiators had just settled a sanitation strike in New York City, and an army of satisfied sanitation workers were clearing the mountains of smelly garbage from the sidewalks and streets. "You think we could just purchase a body bag?" I said. "We'll put her out front on the heap in the back, and they'll collect her." Our man behind the desk looked as though he were passing a kidney stone and was most relieved when we told him we'd take the Morgan coffin, and he left. "There's a man that has 20 years of extreme unctuousness," Alfie said as he did. Mother Angela would get the cremation package, which was a step up from the step which she had desired. "Just throw me in the River Shannon and let me float away," she once said. The Shannon was what she missed most about Limerick when she was in America. We followed the usual path one takes in preparing a loved one's departure. We put notices in the local papers, got Angela into the coffin and into the viewing area, and waited for friends, family, and assorted bodies to arrive and have a look. The funeral parlor was on West 72nd Street in Manhattan. The chairs were set very formally in rows. We immediately put them in a circle, and someone went out and bought some beer. Drink was taken, and a sing-along began, much to the astonishment of management and visitor alike. Alfie has the best voice in the McCourt family, so he had the refrain, with Frank admirably accompanying him on the harmonica, at which he was more than proficient. We first sang the songs we knew Angela hated. And if she were not dead, she would have arisen and smote us. "Goodbye, Johnny dear, when you're far away. Don't forget your dear old mother far across the sea. Write a letter now and then, send her all you can. And don't forget wherever you live, that you're an Irishman." But we ended with our version of Barefoot Days, the family's anthem. "I can remember how proud we used to be when Dad or Mother would make new shoes for me. That's a feeling you've all had. How new shoes would make you glad. Oh, no wonder we had the blues because we had to wear our shoes. Oh, barefoot days when we were just a couple of kids. Bo-dee-o-dee-o-do. Barefoot days. Oh boy, the things we did. We'd go down to a shady old oak, and with the bent pin for a hook, we'd fish all day, fish all night, but the darned old fish refused to bite. And then we'd slide down some old cellar door, bo-dee-o-dee-o-do, slide and slide, till our pants got tore. Then we'd have to go home, stay in our bed, till Mother got busy with the needle and thread. Oh boy, what joy we had in barefoot days. Bo-dee-o-dee-o-do. Thank you very much, Dan. Great. That's kind of a family anthem. But, the thing about, I grew up in Ireland, and as Dan told you, I'm a Brooklyn kid, and that's why I speak this way. But We went there when I was three. And then when we got there, the twin boys, there were six of us. And my mother and father, and the Frank and the twins and myself. And shortly after we got there, the twins died at about the age of 4 and 4 and a half. And so that we got used to people dying. And you know, when people hear you don't, the people do not die, you know. It's as if you mention the word death, people will say, it's as if it's just catching. They pass away. They leave us. I have about 50 of those euphemisms. They're no longer here with the Lord. She's gone to join her husband in heaven, as if she didn't have enough trouble with the old bastard here on this earth, you know. And it's no longer, it bit the dust and bought the farm. And you know what that one called, bought the farm? It comes from when somebody dies, you get insurance and you pay the mortgage so you can buy the farm. That's right. And then, of course, there is he passed. And the question there is what? And who is going to clean it up? And then they have on the highways, if you die on the highway, they give you a ticket because it says very distinctly, no passing. And so there it is. So we got very used to people dying. In school, 10 of my classmates died. And when between the ages of 6 and 10, and one time, and we got a half day off from school when somebody died for the funeral. So one time it was August, we were playing, and the word came that Paddy O'Brien, who was then about 8, was close to death. And that was somewhat serious, but the most serious was the fact that we were still on holidays. And that if the funeral came, we had no half day off. So we talked about this matter, and we delegated Brother Frank, who was quite eloquent at that time for his age at 8. He was sent over to talk to Paddy about this business of dying during holidays. It is simply not done. So Frank went over and banged on the door. Mrs. O'Brien came out and she said, Frankie, it's nice to see you. Paddy is inside. So he went in, and Paddy was inside looking like the last survivor of Auschwitz, sunken cheeks and everything. And Frank, not, you know, mincing words, says, you know, Paddy, you know that you're dying. I know, said Paddy. And Frank says, you know, it's August. I know it's August. Well, what are you going to do about it? What do you want me to do about it? You should not die. You should not die during the holidays. What do you want me to do? And Frank said, if you die during August, I'll come back and kill you. So Paddy was very good. He did not die until September, and we got the days off. Now, again, the attitude towards death is that we had hundreds of years of British rule, and everybody thought that worse than that, nothing could be worse than British rule, because it's totally conservative, you see. And you know, conservatism is a form of brain damage. And as John Stuart Mill said, not all conservatives are stupid, but all stupid people are conservative. And so, after 800 years of conservative rule, we were a bit tired. So death in most cases would be. So there was a case where a man in Guinness Brewery, which is the largest brewery in the world, and it has huge vats, millions of gallons of porter in there. So one of the guys is walking across the little bridge between two of these vats, and he fell in and he drowned. So the foreman says, this is terrible, somebody's going to have to, is going to have to tell the family what happened. Anybody know where he lives? So Malloy said he did. So he was delegate, he said, be gentle now, diplomatic. So, you know, when you break the news. And so he went over, banged on the door, a woman came out and he said, are you the widow McCann? Yeah. She allowed as she was, and he told her the news. So the foreman invited her to come over, and she said, what happened? Well, he fell in, and he drowned, but it took him a half an hour. My God, she said, how did it take too long? He had to get out twice to piss. So, when they were building the Brooklyn Bridge, of course, there was a large contingent of Irish built that, and there were a lot of fatalities, with the result that they had to issue an accident form, and McIntyre was the foreman, had to fill out this form, and so it said Lillis fell off the bridge and broke his neck. So he put down Patrick Lillis, one peck place, and accident. Describe accident. Lillis fell off the bridge and broke his neck. And then down below it said comments. And he's a bit puzzled by this, so he wrote, he didn't make any. So that was that. So, growing up a Catholic, it was an exercise in what I call ecclesiastical terrorism. And so consequently, I put up with it for years. But now I'm an atheist, thank God. And people are constantly getting atheism mixed up with morality. And it's, bless you, my child. Now the thing about atheism, we live in a kind of a natural society. It's not supernatural. I cannot believe that there's a guy, a kind of a mafia chief in the sky, who, if you offend him, you will be sent to a place where there's constant fire, where they're sticking red hot pitchforks up your arse and into your armpit. They're piling coals upon you. They're screaming at you, beating you. There's an awful noise. Saint Augustine said that one of the advantages of being a canonized saint, now you have to be canonized to do this, they give you your own trap door to look into hell, to look at how all the sinners are being punished there. So I think I don't want that view. Anyway, and then they say that the other side of it is that you are rewarded by being sent to heaven, where you sit at the right hand of God. Now, if you're seated at the right hand of God, you have to look at his right earlobe, and that's supposed to be eternal happiness. But looking at him, you have to look left. And there I am on the other side with Karl Marx on the left, yes. And so on. So I wouldn't want to hang out with the guy. I would sooner hang out with Charles Manson than hang out with the guy who invented hell. The imagination that you could think for all eternity you are going to be burned up. So I don't approve of that at all. So that's why I'm not sure about. Diane and myself go every Sunday to. There's a Buddhist meeting up on at Goddard Riverside, and Last Sunday, the speaker was talking about the five precepts of Buddhism. And number one is do not kill, two, do not lie, and number three, do not steal. Number four, do not abuse your own or anybody else's sexuality. And number five, do not get intoxicated. Otherwise, you'll have to do things that you cannot be responsible, that you are not responsible for, and that you are responsible for if you do. Now, I am also a recovering alcoholic, a recovering smoker, a recovering Catholic. I'm recovering from everything. But it's on a daily basis. So anyway, I like those precepts, but why not? And the ethical culture society, I love that. I just embrace ethical. I hug culture, and I love society. I mean, just, it's such a beautiful concept to that you do things just because they're the right, it's the right thing to do. Not because you're going to get rewarded or because you're going to get punished. Because, and Mark Twain said, you know, in case of doubt, tell the truth. And mine is, in case of doubt, just simply do the right thing. And also, I have to tell you, there are two places you will never find atheists, in jail or in Congress. And so, and being now being as all my my brothers, so many people that I know are dead, have died, and it's as I said, I'm in the departure lounge. I don't know how long it's going to be. I mean, I don't know if I'll get out of here today, because there might be a conservative here. Murder. They're a terror for that kind of thing. And then, so there's all kinds of things, and I often think about people, about language. And I left school when I was 13, and I don't have a formal education. I never went back to school. And this book is called, you know, Death Need Not Be Fatal, and I'm in a coffin. I had a bit of trouble persuading the publisher to get the coffin and put me in it. But anyway, so anyway, that is my sales talk for this day. But I think so anyway, I'm a bit, I always have to ask Diana about language, because I, first of all, I feel there's no such thing as bad language. There's only bad usage. But I often have to ask about grammatical construction, because I don't know anything about it. I don't know about punctuation or any stuff. I just know. But like Bob Dylan, he says, I don't write songs, I write them down. So, and I don't like jokes either, but I'm going to tell you one that somebody told me, because I didn't understand it, and I had to ask Diana what it was. There's a very well-dressed man standing at a bus stop in Limerick, and he's got a morning suit and a gold tie pin, he's got a bowler hat and a gold top cane and so forth. And a slum kid, probably somebody like me, we lived in the slum, comes out and says to him, what time is the next bus at? And this pedantic old fart says, never end a sentence with a preposition. Ah, what time is the next bus at, fuckface? So I had to ask Diana what a preposition was, but that was when I asked you to marry me. But it is, so anyway, I say there are words in the language that are very offensive, things like hate. If you say fuck on television, they'll take you off, you know. But yet, you know, on television, if you look at those agricultural programs, you'll see a lot of animals running around, chickens, cursing, fuck. And so, but there are offensive words in the language, but some of them might offend, you know, like, you know, hate and kill and Trump and so forth. But you know, if you find they are, I don't deliberately use words to offend people, but sometimes they are the only ones available to you. And they're all, and if they would not have been invented, indeed, if they have not been invented. I also want to say that there's part of the contribution today also goes to an organization which I want to put a plug in. It's called JobPath, and for people with developmental disabilities, and it does a lot of work in, and Nina is looked after by these folks, and it is for people to make them, as I say, productive members of society. They can get them jobs that they can do or train them to do it and so forth. So when you think about making people happier, JobPath is a good one to have a look at. And then about the coffin. Yes, we rented a coffin up in Rhinebeck, and so the undertaker and his son, teenage son, and the kid said, I was teasing him, you know, teenagers, like, you can always tease them, they're great. And he said, I haven't had so much fun and all the time I've been in the business. I said, I'm the first live corpse you've ever had, you know. So look at the coffin with golden handles. Isn't it grand, boys, to be bloody well dead? Let's not have a sniffle. Let's have a bloody good cry. And always remember, the longer you live, the sooner you bloody well die. Look at the mourners, bloody great boozers. Isn't it grand, boys, to be bloody well dead? Let's not have a sniffle. Let's have a bloody good cry. And always remember, the longer you live, the sooner you bloody well die. Look at the preacher, bloody great hypocrite. Isn't it grand, boys, to be bloody well dead? Let's not have a sniffle. Let's have a bloody good cry.